Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Voice Catchers, How Marketers Listen In to Exploit Your Feelings, Your Privacy, and Your Wallet, by Joseph Turow. Narrated by Joe Hempel. Introduction. Here comes the voice intelligence industry. Your voice is unique. No one else has it. And because your voice belongs to no one else, it's extraordinarily valuable, not only to you, but also to a new sector of society that is designed to exploit it, the voice intelligence industry. Built by marketers to collect information from the ways individuals talk and sound, this industry is deploying immense resources and breakthrough technologies based on the idea that voice is biometric, a part of your body that those in the industry believe can be used to identify and evaluate you instantly and permanently. Companies are working to analyze your vocal cord sounds and speech patterns for information about your emotions, sentiments, and personality characteristics, all so that they can better persuade you, often in real time. Soon, they may be able to draw conclusions about your weight, height, age, ethnicity, and more, all characteristics that scientists believe are revealed by your voice. Marketers will be able to score you as more or less valuable, show you different products based on that valuation, give you discounts that are better or worse than the ones they give other people, and treat you better or worse than others when you want help. In other words, marketers are using voice data to model ways to discriminate between you and others in unprecedentedly powerful ways. And all of this is happening without adequate regulations and safeguards to help American consumers understand the risks. The aim of this book is to describe this developing domain, explain how it's already influencing our lives, and show what about it needs to be stopped. Now is the time to promote perspectives and policies to derail the voice-based world of marketing biometrics while the industry is still being built, and before socially corrosive processes linked to it become too entrenched to change. The emerging voice intelligence industry involves such tools as smart speakers, car information systems, customer service calls, and connected home devices like thermostats and alarms. When you talk, their intelligent assistants can draw inferences about you using analytical formulas generated by artificial intelligence. In the United States and European Union, the best-known assistants tasked with performing such activities are Amazon's Alexa, Google Assistant, and Apple's Siri. In China, Baidu is doing it with its DuerOS voice assistant, and Alibaba with Tmall Genie. Each carries out its work through tens of millions of smart speakers, Wi-Fi-linked audio devices, smartphones, and car audio systems. Google Assistant, accessed mostly through smartphones and Google Home products, is now available in more than 1 billion devices. Amazon claims that its Alexa personal assistant is present in hundreds of millions of devices. A different, though related, ecosystem of firms is creating voice initiatives propelled by artificial intelligence in customer contact centers. Public attention to the voice industry has centered primarily on smart speakers. Dubbed voice-first devices by marketers, these are cylinders, or more recently, other shapes, that sometimes come with screens. Ask a question or make a request, and the device can access a huge number of information sources, including app-like add-ons contributed by thousands of companies, nonprofits, and even individuals. Owners most typically use the devices to check the weather, set timers, learn recipes, listen to music, play games, ask for facts, and buy things. In the United States, the explosion of smart speaker sales began around 2014 with the introduction of Amazon's Echo and its assistant, Alexa. The Google Home came out almost exactly 2 years later. And then smart speakers from other firms came tumbling out. Apple and Samsung used pre-existing assistants, Siri for Apple, Bixby for Samsung. And companies like Sonos built speakers that link to Alexa or Google Assistant, or both. Press attention during this period has seesawed between the latest capabilities built into these devices and the new social dangers they represent. Many stories center on the smart speaker's ability to listen and then answer. The gizmo starts recording whenever it hears the wake word, Alexa, Hey Google, Siri, and it tracks sound for up to 60 seconds each time. Ask, Alexa, what's the temperature in Chicago? And a, so far, immutable woman's voice will provide a direct response. Try, Hey Google, how many plays did Shakespeare write? And a female voice, which in this case you can change to male, will give a concise and correct answer, 37, along with two sentences that elaborate. But there have been incidents. A 6-year-old girl in Texas used Alexa to order a $170 dollhouse and 4 pounds of sugar cookies by simply asking for them. An Amazon user in Germany requested data about what he had said to the device, and he instead received 1,700 audio recordings of someone he didn't know. Alexa users have reported bursts of unexpected and scary laughter coming from the cylinder. A woman in Portland, Oregon, found out that the Echo had recorded a conversation she had had with her husband without the couple's knowledge, then sent the recording to a random person on their contacts list. Amazon had rational explanations for all these issues: a parent not setting the purchase protection code, an Amazon employee's error, Alexa's mistakenly hearing a command to laugh, a rare combination of speaking and listening accidents. As unlikely as this string of events is, we are evaluating options to make this case even less likely, was the official comment on the Portland couple's case. But it could have been the same for any of them. The voice firms are also playing whack-a-mole with hackers and trying to rid the system of bugs that could open the data to snoopers. A writer wryly described one of the privacy intrusion incidents as the latest nightmare scenario for the tech-phobic. The real difficulties with the smart speakers and the voice intelligence industry, however, have yet to emerge. The unwanted incidents will come not from bugs, hacks, or glitches, but from features of technology that work properly. That's because the system is evolving into a blueprint for marketers to use your body signals for gain. Consider. A cartoon drawing accompanying an Amazon patent depicts a woman coughing with a sniffle as she tells one of Amazon's smart speakers, I'm hungry. The device picks up speech irregularities that imply a cold, based at least in part on an analysis of pitch, pulse, voicing, jittering, and/or harmonicity of a user's voice, as determined from processing the voice data. Based on that conclusion, Alexa asks if the person wants chicken soup. And when she says no, offers to sell her cough drops with 1-hour delivery. The scenario may sound helpful, but learning how often someone will need to drink chicken soup and agree to buy cough drops can lead to an AI program drawing inferences about a person's short or long-term health. These conclusions would have marketing value. Knowing via voice if someone is sick could benefit Amazon Pharmacy, the firm's advising, ordering, and delivery service for prescription medicines. Another patent has Alexa listening through a smart speaker for keywords, such as enjoyed or love. When it hears a trigger word, it captures adjacent audio that can be analyzed on the device or remotely to figure out what the person enjoyed or loves. The individual might say, I enjoy traveling to San Francisco, or I love hip-hop, or I love Judy. Tracking the keywords would allow Amazon to add information to people's profiles so it can sell them items related to what they like and not what they dislike, and sell advertisers the ability to reach people with messages that reflect those sentiments. Amazon and its advertisers may also avoid making offers to people who say they love or enjoy what the advertisers disapprove of, or who, for personal or cultural reasons, don't use those specific words to express happiness. A Google patent application describes the firm's ability to use characteristics of audio signatures, such as speech patterns, pitch, etc., to figure out who is in a room, whether they are moving or performing other actions, and how quietly they are doing it. Google describes a situation where parents can know from afar whether their children are sleeping or whispering. The latter, says Google, would indicate mischief is occurring, and the system would notify parents and other adults so they could exercise control. The patent clearly aims at building the firm's smart home business, an enterprise centering around devices like lamps, thermostats, and locks that respond to an owner's commands through voice and touch. Two Amazon representatives who wanted anonymity told me it is company policy not to comment about patents. Both also said patents take a long time to bear fruit. That should not prevent our discussing them. Amazon, Google, and other voice intelligence firms are in business for the long term, and our society will likely continue to be influenced by their innovations for generations to come. In fact, as if to underscore the utility of those patents, Amazon announced during fall 2020 that its just-released Halo Health and Wellness Band is able to analyze the tone of its owner's voice for qualities like energy and positivity. Amazon declared that getting people to consider the emotions that their voice emits will encourage them to adopt healthier communication practices with their loved ones and bosses. The company asserted that the Halo's security features would make its analysis off-limits to anyone but the person speaking. The voice profile, too, is explicitly not for use by third parties. Yet in the face of all the developments you'll see in this book, it is hard not to understand the Halo's professed capability as a proof of concept. The entire voice profiling idea demonstrated here can, as the patents suggest, easily be ported to the marketing realm and beyond. Moreover, the building blocks for the patent scenarios are already in place. Voice discrimination already goes beyond what Amazon and Google do. The customer phone service, or contact center business, was first out of the gate in profiting from individuals' unique voices. Contact center firms such as Nuance and Verint already evaluate a caller's sounds and linguistic patterns for emotion, sentiment, and personality. Linking those biometrics with the caller's name, the firms regularly tell reps to give discounts to tense-sounding customers who are big spenders in order to mollify them. Contact center software also routinely shunts customers pegged as talkative to reps with a track record of getting along with such people and of getting them to spend extra money, upselling them. The voice intelligence industry argues that the assistants are programmed only to help people in a range of everyday activities on the phone, at home, in cars, in stores, and on streets. But they are tied to advanced machine learning and deep neural network programs that companies can use to analyze what individuals say and how they say it, with the goals of discovering when and whether particular people are worth persuading, and then finding ways to persuade those who make the cut. Amazon and Google, the highest profile forces in voice today, are not yet using the maximum marketing potential of these tools, evidently because they are worried about inflaming social fears about the collection of people's voices. But contact centers, which are out of the public eye and thus more audacious about dealing differently with people based on how they talk, may represent the future. As people get used to giving up their voice virtually everywhere, stores, banks, and other sellers that develop their own voice assistants will have fewer qualms about exploiting what their customers say and how they say it. Google and Amazon may ultimately feel compelled to join them. We accept marketers' assurances about voice information privacy at our peril. Marketers have approached voice as an exploitable part of the human body that doesn't have the negative associations of facial recognition. This relatively blank slate, they believe, offers an opportunity to cultivate trust. Yet the voice profiling activities that already happen every day raise many ethical issues. Should it be socially acceptable when what people say to their voice assistants and how they say it is being preserved by the assistant's firm for purposes we don't know and that the firm might not know either? Is it okay when a call center computer senses a caller's anger and posts real-time messages to the service representatives about what words will likely calm the caller? Or when, as is the aim of a U.S. patent application, a bank's call center analyzes the emotions in a person's voice to decide whether that person is a good risk for a loan? Also worrisome are unanswered questions related to political power. The prospect of tracking people and controlling them is as appealing to political campaigns and government agencies as it is to commercial marketers. Facial recognition surveillance, a stock in trade of governments for public security, doesn't yet reach into the recesses of people's homes and personal lives. But voice does. It shouldn't be surprising, then, that as voice profiling becomes the first technology system to reach into our public and private lives with biometric analysis, political marketers and governments are taking notice. Consider just a few possibilities. A political campaign that can sense people's voice responses to the political message at the beginning of a phone call and use that data to decide on the fly how to describe that candidate's beliefs. A political marketer who streams certain commercials only to those individuals whose comments and voice characteristics suggest an openness to extreme arguments the marketer wouldn't want others to see. A police department that arrests someone because publicly placed microphones note a voice pattern predictive of subsequent violence when he mentions an elected official in conversation. A government agency that decides whom to imprison and torture, not only because of what the accused said, but how he or she said it. Such consequences may seem hard to accept in these early days of the voice intelligence era, when assistants like Amazon's Alexa, Google Assistant, Apple's Siri, Microsoft's Cortana, Samsung's Bixby, Nuance's Rita, and Bank of America's Erica seem so engaging, helpful, and harmless. The personal and social costs of these technologies will emerge, however. The voice intelligence industry is in what several insiders I interviewed for this book called a scale-building period. Each brand of intelligent agent is working to create technologies and experiences that will seduce huge numbers of people to become habituated to its offerings. We basically envision a world where Alexa is everywhere, one Amazon executive put it in 2018. Once the company becomes a firm part of many people's lives, and once its engineers have figured out the best ways to turn what it knows about its customers into profits, the scale-building period will end, and the hardcore use of their voice data for profiling and discriminatory offers will begin. Hewing to the letter, if not the spirit, of whatever privacy laws exist, the company will roar ahead in its new incarnation, even if most of its users joined when that business model did not yet exist. The classic bait and switch marked the rise of both Google and Facebook. Both companies attracted colossal numbers of adherents when their business models did not require manipulating massive numbers of data points about them. Facebook especially benefited from the network effect. Friends' participation means that you're likely to use that social network more than others. Only when the numbers flocking to these sites became large enough to attract high-paying advertisers did their business models solidify around selling ads personalized to what Google and Facebook knew about their visitors. By then, the sites had become such important parts of users' daily activities that they felt they couldn't leave, despite their concern about data flows they didn't understand and couldn't control. If we look carefully at where voice firms today are building scale and where other marketers are pushing to piggyback on that scale, we can begin to understand future business uses of voice, as well as what political campaigns, police, and government agencies could do with these tools. In later chapters, with these goals in mind, I will unpack attempts by the major voice companies and marketers to install, implement, celebrate, and profit from voice intelligence technologies. First, however, I will use a social framework to help explain why marketers are chasing voice and what an examination of the voice intelligence industry can tell us about surveillance generally. In recent years, there has been a great deal of scholarly and journalistic investigation of social monitoring and privacy. Much has been written, too, about the consequences of surreptitious tracking and unchecked data collection, plus the non-transparent, often discriminatory use of information acquired without knowledge or consent. But the forces that lead audiences to be ensnared in these activities have received less attention. We know little about how industries in key sectors of public life seduce populations into using technologies for the industry's surveillance aims, how they turn digital surveillance into habits of everyday life, and then make uncoupling from them extremely difficult. In investigating these processes in this book, I will be exploring an industry whose creation is still playing out. By calling attention to these developments while the voice surveillance industry is still in a formative stage, I hope to make it easier for activists and citizens to stop at least the most objectionable practices before they become too ingrained in our everyday lives. Throughout, I will keep an eye on four related corporate strategies that are shaping the evolving industry. One is the spiral of personalization that drives much of 21st century marketing. Another, seductive surveillance, describes how companies attract people to their technologies by playing up the device's allure and playing down their creepy features. The third, habituation, explores how companies help people become accustomed to their tracking technologies. And the fourth, resignation, refers to how the industry works to make sure that, despite their worries, people continue to use these technologies because they believe digital surveillance is unavoidable. Taken together, the analysis of these strategies can help us, the users of these technologies, understand what is going on and what we can do about it. The spiral of personalization is the guiding spirit behind the new marketing order. Marketers believe that in order to remain competitive, they must gather as much data as possible about current and prospective customers and send them individualized messages and product offerings. Yet because of the very nature of this work, marketers never feel they are doing enough to know their targets and reach them efficiently. They will always be looking ahead to technologies like voice intelligence that promise new forms of information made possible by greater intrusions into people's lives. That is, today's new technology will soon also fail to satisfy the drive to uncover deeper knowledge of the customer, leading to the next innovation. For instance, linking voice intelligence to even more intrusive technologies. This unending spiral of personalization will, if left unchecked, ratchet personal surveillance higher and higher with little attention to the social costs, chief of which are the continued erosion of anonymity as a value and a decline in the very freedom of choice that the industry contends is its greatest gift to its customers. As a marketing approach, personalization is both old and new. Street peddlers have always used their understanding of their customers to sell goods. One way to do that was to cover a limited territory and return regularly to the same villages where they could develop ongoing relationships with individual customers. The peddlers offered their goods to buyers they knew, and after haggling to reach an acceptable price, they typically took notes about the final deal so they would be consistent from one sale to the next. The repeated transactions motivated buyers and sellers alike toward honesty and fair dealing. Starting in the 19th century, the peddling business in North America slowed as shoppers turned to small dry goods emporia, grocery stores, and general stores. But the selective presentation and pricing of goods based on the proprietor's knowledge of buyers continued. By the late 19th and early 20th centuries, though, these small operations increasingly gave way to department stores and self-service food markets with many clerks whom the owners didn't necessarily trust to judge people well or bargain successfully. To get around that difficulty, proprietors put out all the goods they sold for everyone to see, and they posted prices that everyone would have to pay. The result was a 20th century democratized retail environment. Anyone who walked into a store would see the same choices and prices that everyone else saw. Of course, the retailing world wasn't nearly as democratic as it claimed to be. In ethnically and racially divided cities, different neighborhoods often saw very different products and prices. And certainly, small merchants with personalized approaches to clients continued to exist. But mass equality was the ideal, and personalization was pushed to the side. Reaching huge populations was also the goal of the 20th century's rising advertising industry. Advertising itself goes back millennia. Some call it the second oldest profession. For most of that time, it was a handicraft activity practiced by the creator of the product to be advertised, or by someone that person had hired to write handbills or announcements placed in narrowly circulated newspapers, books, and magazines. This changed during the 19th century Industrial Revolution, when what we know as the advertising industry was born. During this time, new routinized approaches to production led factories to turn out all kinds of products previously made by hand in huge numbers and at much lower prices than before, as well as novel products like toothpaste, cornflakes, safety razors, and cameras. The large number of items encouraged competition among manufacturers of similar goods, who turned to advertisers to increase sales. These advertisers, who often looked to the immigrant-swollen cities with their many stores for new customers for their clients, placed ads in magazines like the Saturday Evening Post and newspapers like New York World, which reached tens of thousands or even hundreds of thousands of middle and upper-middle-class people. The periodicals, in turn, charged readers little, typically the price of delivery, in order to gather the huge audiences that advertisers were paying to reach. Commercial radio, beginning in the 1920s, and commercial television, beginning in the late 1940s, initially followed the same model. In their cases, no-fee access by the public, buy the radio, plug it in, turn the dial, was supported financially by advertisers seeking mass audiences. Despite mainstream sponsors' focus on the mass market, with audiences as large as possible, some businesses thrived by pursuing much smaller slivers of the sales arena. A small but important area involved personalization, in the peddler's sense of learning as much as possible about an individual, though the firms did it through investigations rather than personal interactions. Prominent among these were credit bureaus, which arose in the late 19th century to help merchants figure out how risky it would be to deal with people who wanted to take home a product and pay for it over time. Although some of these firms produced little more than blacklists of debtors and delinquents, others developed ratings systems and reference books that contained estimates of thousands of individuals' ability to pay their bills. These bureaus proliferated from the first half of the 20th century until the 1980s, when a few firms, having leveraged the efficiency of computers to collect and store credit information, bought out all their competitors. The three national bureaus that eventually emerged from that consolidation owned databases with personalized files for more than 100 million individuals. Unlike medieval peddlers, these giant credit bureaus had no relationships with the people they were scrutinizing. Still, people who received low credit scores often reacted by finding out what they could do to raise their monetary reputations. Other marketing and media businesses also focused on particular segments of the mass market, but they weren't nearly as individualized as credit bureaus when it came to describing or interacting with their target audiences. The technologies of printing and broadcasting didn't allow them to personalize the creation or distribution of their articles or programs. Instead, they created specialized publications for demographic groups they had identified as large enough to be monetarily useful, such as farmers, college students, immigrants speaking different languages, African Americans, religious groups, and the wealthy, and used them to advertise products that were popular with those demographic groups, or that those groups in particular needed. In a mutually reinforcing process, magazines, newspapers, local radio stations, and local television stations began to survey their audiences to learn their buying habits. Then they tailored their content to attract the most advertisers. In the decades after World War II, marketers and media firms began to divide groups of people not just according to demographic categories like gender, income, race, or age, but also by geographic location, lifestyle preferences such as hunting, skiing, owning a pet, or being a food connoisseur, and political and cultural values. Segmentation became a buzzword among marketers and media firms. The proliferation of cable television channels in the 1980s pushed segmentation into high gear. Media firms sold their audiences to advertisers in chunks. Success depended on the number of people in the targeted segments who bought an issue, viewed a program, or passed a billboard. The interaction between the advertisers and the audiences went almost entirely in one direction. Measures of the actual audience interactions with the ads were rare and very delayed. Instead, media and advertising firms typically relied on various forms of survey research, such as the Nielsen Company's familiar ratings of TV viewership, to measure their success. Sometimes the demographic, even psychographic segments that marketers identified were large enough and attractive enough that firms didn't just advertise differently to them, but also created variations of popular products, brand extensions, specifically for them. In the old days, a Procter & Gamble executive noted in 1994, Tide was one big brand. It stood for clean, white clothes, and all women 18 to 49, whether they had kids or didn't have kids, washed their clothes with it. But now you have Tide with bleach, Tide Ultra, Tide Unscented. And each of these brands are still targeted at women 18 to 49, but they are targeted at differences between segments of women 18 to 49. Little did this Procter & Gamble executive know that the same year he spoke so confidently about segmentation, 1994, the commercial internet would emerge with the development of the popular Mosaic web browser. Following a 1993 siren call in Adweek that the internet is opening up to tens of millions of personal computers, companies invested in the web began to move advertisers away from segmentation toward the first widespread push toward marketing personalization since the age of itinerant peddlers. Using computers to tailor many different messages to different individuals became efficient in ways that traditional media could never achieve. Many in the industry thought of the shift from segmentation to personalization as an idealized, electronic vision of the traditional salesperson's ability to learn just what a customer wanted through one-to-one interactions. At first, personalization used many of the same social categories as segmentation, but it increasingly allowed marketers to link those aspects of individuals' backgrounds and lifestyles to specific behaviors both on and off the internet. The capability started with the internet industry's creation of cookies and other tags, which allowed publishers, websites, and then apps to follow, record, and store individuals' movements on their sites and elsewhere in digital space. By getting users to log in with email addresses and passwords, publishers could learn their visitors' names and addresses, and then purchase more information about their gender, age, income, and purchasing habits from data brokers who themselves used the internet as a feeding ground for data. The publishers offered marketers the ability to reach the specific people they cared about or who had the alignment of characteristics that the marketers wanted. Moreover, media firms auctioned off to advertisers, often in real time, those individuals using the web, apps, and increasingly digital television and radio who had particular interests and buying power and who were logging on from specific locations. For example, working mothers who can afford a luxury SUV seem to be in the market for a new vehicle and are at an airport. Immediate measures of the individual's interactions with the ads and the content around them became common. Moreover, the commercial messages, and sometimes the actual items, that marketers showed individual users grew increasingly personalized. Publishers themselves followed this approach. Two people visiting the same site at the same time could see different goods, stories, prices, and discount coupons, depending on the publisher's profiles of them. Even though research showed that Americans don't like the idea, and even though the algorithms that drove the conclusions could be based on prejudicial samples or assumptions, these practices were and are completely legal. Beyond certain areas of health and financial information, few nationwide regulations govern the gathering, exchange, and use of data about people in the digital realm. The Federal Trade Commission's response so far has been to encourage companies that use people's data to self-regulate around the principles of giving people notice and some measure of choice, even if the choice is only to leave the site or app. In recent decades, a major industry has grown up around personalization. The momentum was such that a 2019 report from the Gartner consulting firm called personalization a top priority for application leaders working on digital commerce and customer experience. Gartner's all-encompassing conception of the process goes beyond linking individuals to the traditional segmentation categories to include such things as where the individuals are when the marketer is communicating with them, what products they like to buy with other products, favorite brands, frequented events, most liked sales associates, and most used products. Gartner suggests that knowing individuals' interests and hobbies, family relationships, opinions, and attitudes, their friends on social media such as Facebook or Instagram, and even which of their devices at home are connected to the internet, smart speakers, thermostats, lamps, can help generate a comprehensive profile of a customer's life. All this information, the report notes, can be captured in a CRM, Customer Relationship Management, system, where a detailed customer profile can be maintained to enable a 360-degree view. Of particular importance, according to the report, is an ability to reach the same individuals across all the media outlets they visit. Sometimes the data can be used for advertising to particular groups of people, for example, women with specific cooking-related hobbies. But increasingly, the information is used to help the company advertise to the profile created around a particular person, or what Gartner calls that individual's personas and motivators. Marketing experts often use the term big data to describe the high volume, velocity, and variety of information they collect to make personalized inferences about individuals and predict their actions. This new level of specificity means the strategy of dividing the audience into chunks and then marketing to the different chunks has become increasingly obsolete. Data science is upending the idea of segmentation, said the director of an analytics lab in 2017. His goal is instead to crunch many bits of information regarding individual shoppers, forecast their behavior, and set up structures to sell them efficiently. This method typically requires complex mathematical tools called predictive analytics. Specialists in this area use data mining, logistic regression, and cloud computing to track people's everyday activities via the little data breadcrumbs that you leave behind as you move around the world, in the words of MIT computer science professor Alex Pentland. Catalina Marketing, a company that follows people's purchases at store checkouts, used a different metaphor. Like fingerprints, the firm wrote in an online 2015 brochure, every shopper's profile is unique in the assortment of products they buy each year. Using information about these trails of purchases and increasingly complex models, marketers and publishers created profiles of individuals that scored their value to a merchant, calculated the chances they would click on particular ads, and predicted whether it would be worth showing them a specific product. This puts to commercial use Eric Schmidt's comment when he was Google's CEO that the information Google collects on individuals enables it to know roughly who you are, roughly what you care about, roughly who your friends are, to the extent that it knows its customers better than they know themselves. The glitch in this one-to-one nirvana is revealed by Schmidt's use of the word roughly. The aim of the personalization drive is to surpass any customer smarts that an old-fashioned salesperson could develop. But the collection of data points about people and their behavior that marketers bring together is sometimes wildly inaccurate. The secret worry of internet marketing, a view that burst into the open during the 2010s, is that tracking, profiling, and targeting are fraught with challenges for the entire digital ecosystem. Data may not be up to date. Profiles may be created based on multiple users of a computer or phone. Names may be confused, and people may lie about their age, income, or even gender in order to confuse digital marketers. Advertisers are also uneasy with the well-known problems of click fraud and ad blocking. Click fraud takes place in pay-per-click advertising when the owners of digital locales that post ads on a domain are paid according to the number of visitors to those domains who click on the ads. The fraud happens when a site or app owner pays people or creates an automated script to click on ads to accumulate money deceptively. Ad blocking is using software, less commonly computer hardware, to remove advertising content from a web page or app. While industry players debate the specific reasons for these activities and have tried a variety of solutions, they agree that they cause substantial economic losses. A 2018 study by Adobe found that as much as 28% of all website ad traffic was click fraud. A 2017 report by the Juniper Consultancy projected just 9% for 2018. But even that lower proportion would cost the industry about $19 billion despite major attempts to combat it. Juniper estimated by 2022, ad fraud would cost the industry $44 billion annually. As for ad blocking, eMarketer found in 2018 that one quarter of all U.S. internet users, 71 million people, block ads on at least one device on a regular basis. The firm added that this share will continue to rise as consumers express frustration with their digital advertising experiences. Confronting all these problems in a November 2019 report, Gartner noted that marketers' efforts at personalization were also being frustrated by a continuing decline in consumer trust and increased scrutiny by regulators. Gartner's head marketing analyst explained that consumers have developed an increasingly jaundiced eye toward marketers' efforts to embrace them, and that their increasingly cluttered email inboxes and mobile phone notification centers may lead them to ignore even the most carefully personalized and contextualized message. Perhaps more important, Gartner's survey of marketers showed that roughly a quarter believed that weaknesses in data collection, integration, and protection are obstacles to personalization. The company predicted that by 2025, 80% of marketers who have invested in personalization will abandon their efforts due to lack of ROI, return on investment, the perils of data management, or both. This odd conclusion contradicts the consultancy's own writings. Just months earlier, Gartner had heralded the importance of tailored communication. Customers expect to be recognized and want their experiences personalized, stated a Smarter with Gartner online essay in April 2019. It suggested that tensions around data use could be eased by being upfront with customers about what data would be used, where, and in what context. That suggestion would also fit with increasing government demands for data use transparency. But its overriding point was organizations that combine identity data with behavioral data will outpace those that don't. Even the November 2019 report that predicted personalization's demise exhorted marketers to move forward with it, only with more care than previously and with greater input from various groups within their firms. Collaborate with cross-functional teams to align personalization efforts and increase momentum, the firm advised. Sharing control of personalization efforts can lead to shared insight and expand collective impact and ROI. The same report forecast that, by 2024, artificial intelligence identification of emotions will influence more than half of the online advertisements you see. Companies like Amazon, IBM, and Walmart envision a future where they combined biosensors and AEI, artificial emotional intelligence, to detect emotions to influence buying decisions. By definition, using AI to identify individuals' emotions and so decide which online ads to show them is a form of personalization. Rather than dismissing personalization, then, Gartner's list of concerns about it is connected to and explains the never-ending personalization cycle. The marketers I interviewed for this book certainly didn't discuss voice intelligence as a substitute for tracking known people on the web, on apps, in stores, and everywhere in between. In the words of Pete Erickson, whose company creates conferences for voice tech developers, voice is a value added to the current personalization regime, not a replacement. But marketers do see the rise of voice as a new beginning, an opportunity for their data scientists to use artificial intelligence to achieve unprecedented and near immediate insights into shoppers' identities and inclinations without the fraud and other problems with traditional personalization. To people at the leading edge of voice developments, the public's embrace of smart speakers, intelligent car displays, and voice-friendly phones, along with the rise of voice intelligence in call centers, presents an intriguing way to get around the current difficulties of knowing an audience on the internet. Not only can individuals be profiled by the words they choose and by the systematic relationships among them, their speech patterns, they can also be assessed by the physiology of their sounds, their voice, which, according to some researchers, is unique and cannot lie. The hope for a new chance at audience knowledge is where the furious race for the next cycle of personalization begins. Currently, using voice to infer emotions is the centerpiece of this emerging phase. Reading human emotions and then adapting consumer experiences to these emotions in real time will help to transform the face of marketing, says an executive from Affectiva, a consultancy spun off from MIT. Executives in the call services business also see voice-driven personalization as marking a new era with emotions analytics at its heart. The CEO of Clarabridge, a provider of phone response technology, foresees that new voice technologies will help identify key indicators of a particular caller's loyalty, such as effort, emotion, sentiment, and intent. The head of another firm asserts that this drive to personalization is already benefiting from using artificial intelligence to learn deeper meanings in what people say. Companies large and small are rushing to shape this next frontier of personalization. To do it, they are creating a new agenda for mining customers' voices using computer-driven artificial intelligence processes, one that harks back to the work of one-to-one salespeople, but without the give and take, and with the customer having only the dimmest understanding of what is taking place. The hallmark of this new world is what we might call the industrial construction of audiences. Our ideas of who we are will come from the efforts of many organizations working together. Some will provide software, others hardware, others data about individuals, all to create personalized profiling that will predict our commercial value in any given situation. The guiding principle is that the new gold in people's speech is not in what they say, but how they say it and how they sound when they say it. A common way of getting to the nuggets involves machine learning based on samples called training sets. Take two labeled training sets, say one of people who are nervous and one of people who aren't, and feed the data to an algorithm, a dynamic formula that is designed to detect patterns among a large number of data points about speech, tones, speed, emphases, pauses, and much more. Some of these speech characteristics are so complex that only a computer with particular instructions could detect them. Say the algorithm learns to pick up the subtle signs that indicate, at a certain level of statistical confidence, whether a speaker is part of the nervous or non-nervous group, and that it can do the same with new samples in the future. A next step might be to determine whether the nervous-sounding group is more likely to buy certain products, default on loans, or do other things that marketers would find important. Still further steps might involve linking those findings to other knowledge about the individuals. It's possible that adding information about gender, geography, and jobs, for example, could add to the ability to predict whether a nervous person is more likely to buy certain foods, take certain vacations, or return products often. There are other, more complex versions of machine learning. One family of methods, deep learning, uses algorithms in multiple layers that try to find patterns in different aspects of the phenomenon. Say one layer concentrates on the waveband frequencies of the voice and another on the ways syllables are used. These patterns are then analyzed together to draw conclusions about the whole. Optimists about voice profiling point to attempts by healthcare providers to detect diseases such as Parkinson's or post-traumatic stress disorder. Characteristics of a person's voice may even indicate suicide risk, according to a team led by Louis-Philippe Morency, a computer scientist at Carnegie Mellon University. Morency's group tentatively concluded that if people who have attempted suicide have a soft, breathy voice, they are more likely to reattempt than those with tense or angry voices. Such efforts are intriguing, but scientists are at the beginning of a long road with many questions ahead about the accuracy of their results, and whether factors like the instruments they are using or other circumstances of testing, rather than the voice itself, could be influencing their findings. Another concern is the confidence level. How statistically significant should the findings be before they activate social programs, for example, to check the voices of people who have attempted suicide? Should 90% confidence be enough for getting a voice print and potentially disrupting someone's life? Or should 99% be required? And lurking behind all the results is a worry about algorithmic bias, that if the training sets are not large or diverse enough, the conclusions reached might not reflect the entire population and may even lead to discrimination. Consider, for example, if the training set of suicide attempters didn't include people whose voices have always been breathy, regardless of their mental state. If a social policy based on voice tagged them as suicide.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.